Hello, everyone. My name's Ron Realsmith. I'm a member of the Sarnia Historical Society. And today I am joined by the one and only Tom Slater, who is our local historian for the city of Sarnia and just recently finished his fantastic project, which is called the War Remembrance Project. And it's now in its second edition. Is that correct, Tom?
The third and final edition.
Third and final edition.
Yes. The previous edition was in 2014.
Right. So just recently published. And the reason that we're all here once again, taking part in this ceremony this Saturday is because Tom and I were at a Czech presentation for Tom and his latest book earlier this year. And while we were there, Tom looked up and realized that the cenotaph had been damaged and someone had attempted to steal it. And on further inspection, we realized that actually was the case. What has happened over the last few months is we've generated a fundraising campaign that has culminated in the repair of the statue. And it also, funnily, the same year as this year is the 100-year anniversary of the cenotaph being installed. So we had begun talking with Mr. Slater earlier in the year about coming up with a history story of the cenotaph within our community. So without further ado, I'm going to kick it over to Tom. Tom, why don't you provide a little introduction for yourself, and then we'll get into your presentation.
Well, I'll just mention the books. It's entirely a volunteer operation, the books. It was the Historical Society, the City of Sarnia, the Legion, and Blue Water Power funded the printing of approximately 80 books. And those 80 books were distributed throughout the community to high schools, city and county offices, museums, libraries, senior residences throughout the city. So they're available to anyone to read. And then the Historical Society, the City of Sarnia, Lambton Archives, they've all got the PDF version. So anyone can read the entire project. It's meant so people can access these stories of these incredible people that went to war and the families that sacrificed so much.
Mm-hmm. A labor of love for yourself, that's for sure.
Oh, for sure. Well, these guys are inspiring. they're incredible people.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, if you'd like to start your presentation, we'll turn our screen off and you can start your presentation.
Okay. Thanks, Ron. Okay. All right. There are two aspects to the Sarnia Cenotaph. There's the physical structure itself and how it came to be, and secondly, what it symbolizes. The park that the cenotaph sits in, originally known as Market Square, it's been around since the mid-1800s and it's had a long connection with the military. The cannon that you see on the right there came to the park in 1869. It originally came from England during the time of the Fenian raid threat. In this photograph, there's a group of Sarnians are welcoming home men who had returned from the Boer War. The first public library, the Carnegie Library, was opened in 1903. The Boer War Memorial Fountain was erected in now named Victoria Park in 1908. This is a photo looking east, just so perspective of the library, the cannon, the Boer War Fountain is on the right there, and the Granolithic Walk, as it was called. Now, after the First World War, there was a lot of debate in the city as to how they were going to commemorate the fallen. And this local mother, Irene McMullen, had lost her only son in the war, and she wrote a letter to the Observer the same month the war ended, giving her opinion on what she thought. Here's which portion of that letter.
May I speak for my boy? He's sleeping somewhere in France. I do want to tell you what I believe would please him, could he speak. For some years prior to enlisting in Lambton's 149th Overseas Battalion, he had taken great pleasure in the public library and the park surrounding it. And since a memorial to the boys who will never return has been under discussion, my greatest comfort has seemed centered there. And always I can picture to myself a monument of suitable design bearing the names of all our city's fallen heroes, their graves beyond the reach of loving hands to tend and care for, with no mark save a temporary wooden cross.
Now, if I go back to before the war began, it was May of 1914 that Sarnia became an official city. And only 3 months after that, when Britain declared war, Canada went to war. So the ordinary citizens of Sarnia and Lambton volunteered to serve. Here's a group of them leaving from Ferry Dock Hill. Sarnians, as part of the first contingent, trained in England that winter, and by the next spring, they were off to the front lines in France and Belgium. Now, in every major battle that Canadian troops fought in, Sarnians served and died, including in these battles. Canada's first major battle, where poison gas was used for the first time, their baptism by fire. The war was known as a trench war, fought in nightmarish conditions. Soldiers fought each other separated by a barren no man's land of barbed wire, craters, rotting corpses. They faced enemy machine gun fire, snipers, mortars, mines, high explosives, and shrapnel cells. Battles ended with horrific costs, with gains and losses measured in only a few meters. Sarnians were there when the four divisions of the Canadians fought together for the very first time. Soldiers advanced closely behind their own creeping barrage of artillery into the face of the enemy. The soldiers endured extreme weather conditions and mud-filled trenches, living with rats, fleas, lice, and infections. Sarnians served and died in Canada's most decisive victories during Canada's final 100 days campaign. On November 7th, 1918, Sarnians were greeted with this headline, although it turned out to be a premature announcement, because it wasn't until 4 days later that the headlines were in fact true, the war was officially over. Impromptu celebrations in Sarnia began on the day of the 11th and continued into the next day. Thousands were reported to come from all over Lambton County to come into the city to celebrate the event. Known as the War That Will End War, this war of attrition was one of the deadliest conflicts in history. Along with this many number of Canadians killed, at least, thousands more would succumb to their wounds post-war, and many more were hobbled for the rest of their lives with physical wounds and psychological trauma. During the course of the war, families back home, if they'd lost a son or a husband, they received few details, say a telegram such as this. This is the one that Mrs. McMullen received informing her of the death of her child. Very few details. So for families at home, their lives were shattered. They were left to wonder where and how their loved ones had died, if they were buried in a grave, and if so, even if their bodies were ever even recovered. There was no closure, no funerals. During the war, bodies of the fallen were either buried in mass graves, or the bodies or remnants of bodies were buried haphazardly close to where they fell, or bodies were never recovered at all. This commission, established in 1917, had the goal to record the details of all the war dead, and they addressed three key issues. They would disinter the bodies scattered in the battlefield graves and bury them in permanent war cemeteries. All fallen would lie together with their comrades, regardless of rank, marked with a white cross. And thirdly, the commission would not repatriate the bodies back to their home countries. So really, for the first time in history, nations wanted to memorialize the war dead individually. So the commission built many war cemeteries and memorials in France and Belgium. Every cemetery would have a stone of remembrance and a cross of sacrifice. With the bodies not being repatriated for bereaved families at home, it meant that they would likely never see the place where their loved ones were buried. Most didn't have the money to afford an expensive trip across the ocean. And for many others, there was no grave to visit. So from coast to coast, families, parents, widows, orphans needed something tangible, something to remember and honor the sacrifices made by their loved ones, a place to grieve, to share the pain and emotion that was felt by so many in the community, something to stand in for the graves that many soldiers never had or that families would probably never see. So across the country, grieving communities came together to erect war memorials such as these. A wide array of them. Two ideas that didn't passed the test. In 1919, the mayor of Windsor, E.B. Winter, he proposed building an international subway under the Detroit River that would link Windsor and Detroit. Another failed idea was from the former defense minister, Sam Hughes, who suggested that the federal government should provide communities with war memorials identical in every respect, except for size, which would vary depending on the percent of population that served overseas. So here are a few of the traditional types of memorials that were built across the country. And thousands of these war memorials were erected in Canada in the 1920s and 30s. So these are some of the different types. You'll see there's Point Edward, common was an obelisk, and cairns were also another popular type of memorial. Now these symbols of remembrance meant to honor the sacrifices of the fallen, and especially for survivors, it was a way to reassure them that their loved ones had not died in vain, that they would not be forgotten. And it was also a way for communities to show they had done their bit, a source of civic pride. And though the type, size, and scale of these memorials varied, they were all similar in three ways. First off, they were all funded by the community, local donations by people, groups, companies. It wasn't the government that paid for these memorials. Secondly, the individual names were engraved into the memorials, providing gravestones in absentia. Usually just the fallen. Sarnia was different in that aspect. And like the cemeteries in Europe, there'd be no distinction based on rank. And third similarity, volunteers were the ones that formed committees to gather the names that would go on these memorials. There was no official government body or military agency that did that. So in Sarnia, the plans to create a memorial began in November of 1918, and it was the Great War Veterans Association that were leaders in that campaign. And this article basically just explains that they don't know whether it's going to be a monument or a building. This is Irene McMullen's letter as it appeared deep in the pages of the Observer in November of 1918. Now, she was a divorced mother. Again, she only had the one child. Her son, Leonard, was 17 years old when he enlisted in Sarnia. And a year and a half later, he was killed in action in a trench in France. You heard a portion of her letter earlier. Here's more of her letter.
Have you a boy sleeping over there? If so, does not the little white wooden cross seem a frail thing? And many of our boys have not even that much. A granite monument would be a memorial which would withstand the elements for many generations to come, and in that way would perpetuate their names as nothing else could. Also, it would be something which the residents of our city and visitors as well would have cause to admire and revere. The little white crosses over there seem to send us the message, do not forget us, though only wrapped in a blanket perhaps and buried khaki clad in a soldier's grave.
So after the war, there was much debate ensued as to what form the Sarnia Memorial should take. There were public meetings at City Hall and discussions and proposals for, quote, a suitable monument for the brave boys who paid the supreme sacrifice and lie under French soil. These are the four big proposals that were submitted to the Memorial Committee. The first one was to purchase a new park and plant oak trees in the park, and each oak tree would have a metal plate with the name engraved of a fallen soldier. Others argued that a veterans home that would be used by soldiers only. Many desired some type of community memorial building that the whole community could use. And others favored the more traditional monument with a war museum. Now the Memorial Committee strongly recommended the proposal of a community memorial building, something that the whole community could use for entertainments, meetings, club gatherings for many years to come. That same month, the Great War Veterans Association, they promoted the idea of a veterans home that would have a swimming pools, billiard tables, meeting rooms, a library that would be used by veterans, the widows, and children of the fallen. Now, ultimately, Sarnia went with the traditional monument, the so-called cenotaph. Now, a bit about cenotaph. Cenotaph is Greek. It literally means empty tomb, and they were common in the ancient world. In ancient Greece and ancient Egypt, they were typically a large block elevated on top of several steps. and they were typically erected to honor an important individual whose remains were buried elsewhere, usually a single person like a political leader or an important soldier or a leader. The first cenotaph as a war memorial is attributed to be beginning here. In the lead up to the signing of the Treaty of Versailles, the British government planned a parade to celebrate the victory and the peace. The British Prime Minister David George asked this British celebrated British architect to build a temporary structure for the parade as a memorial to the dead. So this is Sir Edwin Luton's sketch of his plan. And in 1 month, it was built, made of wood, plaster, and canvas, but made to look like stone. His temporary cenotaph became the focal point of the victory parade. People were moved by it. It came to represent the absent dead and served as a substitute for the tomb. Days afterwards, members of the public began laying flowers and wreaths around the base of the cenotaph. And within a week, over 1 million people had come to the cenotaph to pay their respects to the dead. So soon after the parade, the public generally began pressuring the government, we have to create something more permanent. So 1 year later, a permanent structure made of stone was unveiled by King George V. And from then on, every Armistice Day in England, the main national ceremony of remembrance is held here. The structure is simply referred to as the cenotaph. Now, the cenotaph would influence the design of many war memorials, not only in Britain, but across the Commonwealth. And certainly there were smaller replicas of this in different communities. But here's three area cenotaphs that you see they very much resemble the cenotaph that's in London, England. In Sarnia, it was April of 1921 where the site for the war memorial was chosen, and actual work and construction on the cenotaph began that same month. It would be a large granite foundation, which would support a huge rectangular granite block weighing several tons, and they would bolt several bronze plaques to it. The plaques became a bit of an issue because there was a problem with manufacture and deliver. The plaques were being built in Toronto. So the cenotaph was originally scheduled to be unveiled on the May long weekend of 1921, but because of delays with the plaques, it was moved to July 1st, Dominion Day. Again, delays with the plaques. Then the mayor, George Crawford at the time, visited Toronto factory and he was told, you know what, they're not gonna be ready till Labor Day. So the unveiling was moved to Labor Day. Now in September, plaques still weren't ready. So in late September, this is an article about Mayor Crawford announcing the long delayed unveiling may take place on November 11th, 1921, which is the third anniversary of the armistice. Now at some point, that date was changed again to November 7th, which is Thanksgiving Day. And the logical question is, why would you change it to Thanksgiving Day? Armistice Day. The very first Armistice Day was November 11th, 1919, as declared by King George V, and it took place throughout the Commonwealth. But after 1920, the Canadian government passed a bill, and they decided Armistice Day would be celebrated the same day as Thanksgiving Day, which would be the Monday on the week November 11th fell. Now, this wasn't a popular decision, having Thanksgiving Day and Armistice Day on the same day, and it would take a decade of lobbying by veterans organizations such as the Legion to amend that decision. So it wasn't until 1931 that Armistice Day became Remembrance Day, and it would be always on November 11th. But back in 1921, Armistice Day and Thanksgiving Day were the same. So here's the lead up a couple days before the unveiling from the Observer saying everything's ready for the big unveiling and in Victoria Park on Monday, Thanksgiving Day, November 7th. This is what the original cenotaph looked like when it was unveiled on Thanksgiving Day in 1921. It was a chilly morning, there were overcast, there was a cold wind blowing, rain clouds were hovering overhead. The ceremony began with a parade from City Hall that went to Victoria Park with city officials and veterans and relatives of the fallen, military units, citizens' bands, cadets, Boy Scouts. And then at the park, once they got to the park, you know, there were the usual speeches and hymns and prayers by religious leaders. It was Mayor George Crawford who gave a brief address before carrying out the unveiling. So there was a flag draped over the cenotaph. And just as he was about to pull the flag to unveil the cenotaph, like an omen from above, sunshine burst through the dark clouds. And when the shroud was removed, sun was shining on the granite monument and the bronze tablets. So kind of a special moment. It was a very emotional ceremony, obviously, and it was followed by placing of wreaths and volleys from a firing party, sounding of the last post, the national anthem. On the cenotaph itself, there were four bronze plaques. This plaque was on the north side, and you'll probably notice there's one error here, and that's with the actual date. It wasn't November 11th that was unveiled. There were two very large plaques, one on the north side and one on the south side. And those two plaques had the names of about 1,000 Sarnians who had served in the Great War. And on the west side of the cenotaph was this plaque with the names of 60 fallen soldiers. Here's the part of the write-up from the Observer about the ceremony, and it indicated there were over 3,000 Sarnia citizens witnessed the ceremony. Two side notes: on November 8th, the day after the unveiling, there was a huge snowstorm that hit the city, so they avoided that. And a note on some other area cenotaphs: Sarnia was the first in the area. Petroya, Forest, and Point Edward, they all unveiled their cenotaphs in 1922. Windsor and Strathroy, 1924. Toronto and Woodstock, 1925. London, Ontario, 1934. Now, even during Mayor Crawford's speech on the November 7th, 1921, he stated that, quote, he hopes that a handsome bronze or marble statue of Canadian soldier will be mounted on top of the granite memorial. So here's a newspaper clipping from the summer where telling the Sarnians that Mayor Crawford is endeavoring to secure a suitable soldier statue for the top of our memorial. Now, after the Great War, communities across the country, the demand for monuments and statues was crazy. And there were three companies in particular, all based in Toronto, that were giants in the market. And those are the three companies there. And what you're looking at is a page from this Rogers and Tickle and Sons company that ultimately Sarnia chose. That's the same company that had made the plaques. So once you choose a company, your next question is, what's the statue going to be made of? And generally, the statues are made of either stone or bronze. Now, for the ones made in stone, more than half of the statues made in stone were of an Italian marble. Here are two local examples of marble statues, one in Alveston and one in Oil Springs. Now, marble is less expensive than the bronze. And because marble is relatively brittle as far as a stone and can be easily broken, the figures on these statues are often leaning on a tree stump or a piece of equipment to give it extra strength to make it more secure. And over time, marble is more susceptible to the elements, weather, erosion, and decay. This is Petrolia's cenotaph a few years before its restoration that has taken place. And you can see the lichen growth on the statue. This design is actually a very famous design replicated many times of the grieving soldier. It's interesting to note that the Canadian National Vimy Memorial in France has these allegorical human figures adorning the monument, all done in stone, whereas it's interesting to note that the National Memorial in Ottawa has World War I soldiers instead of allegorical figures, and they're all done in bronze. Now, after deciding what material you're going to go with, the city also had to decide what mood do you want to evoke on that soldier. Do you want to evoke the victory, celebration, happiness, and joy? Or do you want to evoke mourning, loss, grief, sadness, and sorrow? Or do you want to demonstrate moving forward to face the enemy, going into battle, in action? Or something more at ease, more pensive, relaxed, and calm? or something more stoic, portraying dignity, showing pride and honor. And this is the route Sarnia would choose. And then there's also the possibilities of going something more symbolic or allegorical, portraying things with lions and angels in them. Now the soldier on top of our cenotaph is referred to as a Tommy, and that's because World War I soldiers had nicknames for their enemy as they talked to each other across the trenches. So Tommy was the nickname of British soldiers given to them by the Germans. It was comparable to British soldiers calling the Germans Fritz, or the French Palou, or the Americans Doughboy. This is Sarnia's Tommy soldier, sculpted in bronze in 1921 by the Rogers Tickle and Son Company. And here's several other Rogers Tickle and Sons bronze Tommies. And you notice two things. One, they're all the same in these three different centers. And secondly, they're all the same as Sarnia's Tommy. So 1 year after the unveiling of the original cenotaph, here's the Observer story announcing the plans for the parade and rededication of the new cenotaph. The plans would include a parade from City Hall to Victoria Park, again with civic officials, bands, a firing party, veterans, military units, collegiate cadets, Boy Scouts, and ladies auxiliary. So on this day, November 12, 1922, the Sarnia Cenotaph was rededicated with its new bronze statue on top. Captain Reverend A.R. Garrett of Forest, who had lost two of his brothers in the war, he unveiled the memorial with the words, "In loving memory of those from this city who gave their lives for God, for King, and for country." Now, along with the new soldier statue, on the east side of the granite block was also added this bronze plaque, and it bore the names of 42 Sarnia men who had died in the First World War, but had been inadvertently omitted from the original tablets. So here's the Observer report on the ceremony. Of note, Mayor George Crawford, who was a key figure in making the cenotaph and the statue become a reality here in Sarnia, he passed away the very next year in 1923. This is a photo that just kind of puts things in, shows the orientation of the cenotaph on the left there in relation to the library, the cannon on the right, and the Boer Memorial Fountain is back in the deep right there. Now, while this was going on in Sarnia, there was also pressure from the public and veterans groups on the Canadian government to mark the soldiers' sacrifices overseas. So this commission was established in 1920, and they organized a design competition for Canadian memorials to be erected at 8 designated battle sites in France and Belgium. What you're looking at here are the final submissions that the jury selected, and there was one clear winner, but two memorials did stand out. So here's the clear winner, and work on that memorial began in 1925. The other memorial that stood out was unveiled in 1923 in Belgium. And basically the commission said, well, we're not going to replicate that six more times. So what the commission decided to do was create six smaller identical memorials for the other six battle sites. And the design was inspired by the Stone of Remembrance, all of Canadian granite. Inscriptions were in French and English. And you'll probably also notice the similarity this design has to the Sarnia Cenotaph. The Canadian government also worked to create national memorials here at home. The Peace Tower was dedicated in July 1917 when the war was still going on. It was inaugurated in 1927. And the National Memorial in Ottawa, work began on that really in 1925, though it was not unveiled until May of 1939 by King George V. And ironically, sadly, a little over 3 months after that memorial was unveiled, this is what Sarnia citizens read in their paper. And about 1 week later, Canada was at war again. In the Observer, this is the day after war was declared. Again, Sarnia citizens, ordinary citizens, volunteer to go to war. And the article states that after Canada's declaration of war, the result was there was a swamping of local recruiting depot with applicants for enlistment. So the Second World War, whether it was at sea, in the air, or on land, in every battle and campaign that Canadian troops were part of, Sarnia and Lambton citizens fought and died. And so Sarnians fought in all kinds of conditions against an unrelenting and ever increasingly desperate enemy, liberating towns and villages across Europe. Over 3,000 Sarnians would serve in the war, and at least 170 made the supreme sacrifice. And again, by the time the war was over, the bodies were not repatriated, so they lie in overseas war cemeteries or names are inscribed on war memorials. This is a story from the summer of 1942. During the war, beginning in 1941, local residents prepared for possible attack with mock blackouts and air raid attacks. So on this first day of summer in 1942, the Civilian Defense and Air Raid Precautions Committees practiced their emergency preparedness. So at 10:30 at night, a blackout was held in Sarnia and Port Huron. Warning sirens across the area sounded to start the alarm, and within seconds, streetlights, homes, cars, downtown businesses, industry lights, everything went dark. A few minutes later, fire engines, ambulances, utility vehicles were dispatched and raced through the downtown streets in response to the simulated emergency. So picture all of Sarnia and Port Huron in complete darkness, except ironically, the only light visible for miles was a spotlight that illuminated the cenotaph in Victoria Park, which had been mistakenly left on. Now, even before the war ended, there were discussions on how to honor Sarnia's World War II fallen. Captain George Sturt, a local war hero, made a proposal in the fall of 44 that gained a lot of attention. That was the building of a civic center that would combine an arena, a YMCA, and a cultural center, which would include a library and a art museum, all built in the athletic park. Now, Sarnia's mayor at the time, Mayor Carlisle Hipple, who had also served in the war, was not in favor of this huge combination in one memorial on the base that it would be very difficult for the city to operate. Here are two proposals that were submitted to this civic committee by the Sarnia Town Planning Commission, proposals for the memorial. The first one was by some consultants who stated that one of the greatest needs the city needs is a hockey and public arena. The second proposal came from a group of Western Ontario Chemists Association, and they asked for a more elaborate structure that would include not only the rink, but a library, a museum, a lecture theater, an aquarium, swimming pool, gymnasium, basketball, and badminton courts. That same month, Mayor Hipple would announce the personnel that would serve on this committee that would lay the groundwork for this campaign for a new memorial. And he also announced that it was generally agreed that the hockey and public arena is the one favored by the citizens. 5 months later, this is the front page of the Sarnia Observer announcing the total surrender of Germany, though the war was not over yet because we were still at war with Japan. 1 week after this, there was a national day of prayer and thanksgiving for the Allied victory across the country. And in Sarnia, there was a special memorial service at the cenotaph, and it was estimated more than 6,000 citizens attended that ceremony. The same month, Mayor Hipple sent out a letter to a number of organizations interested in promoting the war memorial, where he outlined the three proposals, and he wanted the organizations to discuss the three proposals and choose one. So here are the three proposals in May of 1945. A general purpose auditorium, which would be beside the athletic park. This would be an arena for hockey, skating, sports, exhibitions. The second proposal was a war memorial library building, which would be located on a landscape site like Victoria Park. And it would include a library, a small auditorium, an art gallery, history, hobby, and study rooms, and a small and dignified chapel, so no rink. The third proposal was a memorial recreation center. So this would include an arena as well as playing fields for football and baseball, a recreational building that would allow for meeting places and club rooms, and also accommodated gymnasium. And the idea that this recreation center would be located just outside the present city limits, preferably on the east side of East Street in the vicinity of George Street. Later that month, Mayor Hipple revealed the results of the survey, in which he stated that the majority of the responses are of the opinion that a hockey arena should be a central part of the memorial building to be. So the committee presented the arena proposal to the Legion and the Canadian Corps Association to discuss the location and the costs. Soon after, the Canadian Legion forwarded their own proposal to the committee, that of a memorial park that would include a formal garden and a cenotaph, buildings sort suitable for a cultural education. There'd be no rink, and this would be erected in an area of 40 to 50 acres. Not long after, the Memorial Foundation Committee all resigns. The reasons stated were in part apathy on the part of the public. The Legion didn't want to move forward with any plan until all their members had returned from overseas. And the Canadian Corps Association said that there should be no large recreational project forming the integral part of a war memorial. Now, across Canada, at this time, almost every town in Canada already had a great war memorial. And the question was now, do we build new memorials in our towns and cities? Essentially, there was little appetite for building new stone monoliths. Communities embraced functional memorials that would enrich the lives of the living, like the ones listed there. For example, in Sarnia, what's now Coronation Park, it was suggested that in building that subdivision in the 40s, the street should be named in honor of local fallen soldiers. The view of the Legion at a national level was that these functional memorials would fail to inspire remembrance and reverence. And ultimately, in most communities, the Legion's insistence that existing great war memorials across the country could be adapted to include those killed during World War II won out. Mid-August of 1945, there's the front page of the Sarnia Observer announcing the unconditional surrender of the Japanese, marking the official end of the war. Celebrations in the city began in Sarnia. On the evening of August 14th, news of the surrender was heralded by blowing of factory whistles, ringing of church bells, car horns blowing, impromptu celebrations and cheering and excitement up and down the streets of Sarnia. A few days later, there was a very solemn parade and ceremony at the cenotaph. And that's kind of that bottom set of photos is trying to show. In 1946, planning for a war memorial was rekindled with this committee, and its members included representatives from these three groups. The committee members combined their efforts to compile a list of local men who had made the supreme sacrifice in World War II. And here's their list of names that they had gathered so far, published in the Sarnia Observer, August of 46. Now, not long afterwards, plans for the memorial were aborted again, apparently for several reasons. Now, in the newspaper, the reasons seem rather trivial. The big picture was across Canada, many people wanted to forget about the war at this time. They didn't want to dwell on the painful past. So much had been lost and sacrificed. They didn't want to glorify war. They wanted to look ahead. After all, they'd been through two world wars in 30 years. So that's likely a big part of the reason. It was not until 5 years after the war ended when the Prime Minister Louis Saint Laurent visited Sarnia, and during his time here, he was kind of surprised that there was no cenotaph dedicated to our fallen, and he expressed that disappointment. And only 2 months after the Prime Minister's visit to Sarnia, the Korean War broke out. So once again, Sarnia citizens volunteered to serve, left for overseas, and would fight and die in the hills of Korea for over 3 years. 6 months after the Prime Minister's visit, a new committee would form in response to Saint Laurent's visit, and planning would again begin for a new memorial. This new committee would include Mayor Nelson, Aldermans Paul Blundy and Ivan Walker, and representatives of these local veterans organizations. And suggestions for the new memorial included an annual bursary to further the education of a son or daughter of a fallen soldier, or a park or playground, or the leading one was that of a museum small chapel that would be added to the library. So the that became one step closer when the committee members met with the Sarnia Library Board to discuss that possibility of adding a museum chapel to the library. The outcome of those meetings, nothing ever came of it. The project again died and the committee ceased to operate. So it was not until 2 years later when the Sarnia Sappers Association, which then was the second largest veterans organization in the city, strongly criticized city council for the lack of cooperation in helping to erect a suitable memorial for the World War II dead. And the Legion pledged their support to work with the Sappers to make this happen. And just an aside, that photo with this story is of a local soldier and they're announcing his death in Korea that same month. So days later, Alderman Harry Turnbull, who was a World War veteran himself, said it's time the city of Sarnia did something to provide a fitting and lasting memorial to Sarnia's war dead, and he suggested a new committee should be formed. So more than a month later, the Canadian Legion, along with the Sarnia Sappers Association, announced plans to begin a drive in the new year to obtain a better memorial for the city. The form of that memorial had yet to be decided. The Sarnia Memorial Committee was credited with working to make the new cenotaph become a reality. Its members included Alderman Alex Rapson, Alderman Harry Turnbull, and representatives of all those groups that you see on the screen. More than 20 months later, the Memorial Committee was still seeking data on who made the supreme sacrifice. And this is their list that they had gathered so far, published in the Observer. This is, I think, just a neat photograph of the Sarnia Cenotaph in the November 1954. This is the final year that it was in that state, the year before it was newly renovated. So 1 year later, 1955, here's the Observer article announcing the program for the dedication of the new cenotaph. Businesses were going to be closed in town so people could take part in the ceremony. The ceremony would begin with, again, a parade of civic, military, and veteran units marching to Victoria Park. On November 11th, 1955, the new renovated cenotaph in Victoria Park was rededicated more than 10 years after the end of the Second World War. It was a drizzling rain that morning, cloudy. It began with an opening hymn, religious service, and prayers. It was rededicated by Reverend G. Stone and unveiled by Lieutenant Colonel J. Coleman, who was the commanding officer of the Sarnia Garrison. There was a customary firing of the salute, the last post, 2 minutes of silence, reveille, memorial prayer, and playing of the national anthem. The first wreath laid upon the new cenotaph was by Captain August Menzibal and his wife Mary, on behalf of all next of kin. Now, Augustine was a veteran of the First War, in fact, a military war medal winner, and was then a language teacher and coach at Sarnia Collegiates. The Menzibals had lost their only son, Rodolfo, at age 25 in 1943. He was a RCF fighter pilot. So the new renovated granite monument had been enlarged by the addition of two new wings, which were inscribed the names of Sarnia's fallen soldiers from the two world wars. Four of the existing bronze plaques that had been there prior had been removed and were put into storage. The plan was that they would be placed in some sort of civic center building if it was ever built. Ultimately, at some point in time, those bronze plaques were mounted on the outside west wall of the Royal Canadian Legion. Two new plaques were added. The first one with the names of who rededicated and unveiled the new cenotaph. And this plaque was added with the names of two local fallen from the Korean War. On the south side of the cenotaph, these words were carved in: to keep forever living the freedom for which they died. This symbol has been dedicated to the fallen. Now, 10 years seems like a long time, at least it did to me, to add names to a cenotaph. But if you look at the big picture, the National War Memorial in Ottawa, unveiled in 1939, in the 1940s, again in the 1950s, and even into the 1960s, there were discussions on creating a new memorial by politicians, by veterans groups, and they all fell through. Nothing ever came of it. And in fact, it was not until 1982, 37 years after the end of World War II, that the name, the dates of the Second World War and the Korean War were added to the existing National Memorial. The Korean War Memorial Wall of Remembrance in Brampton, it was dedicated 44 years after the Korean War armistice. And the monument to the Canadian fallen in Korea was unveiled 48 years after the Korean armistice. Now, since 1956, Canada has played a leading role in peacekeeping missions around the world. And Sarnia, Lambton men and women have served in countless missions in Egypt, the Middle East, Bosnia, Haiti, Iraq, Croatia, the Persian Gulf, at least 40 different countries. Canada's peacekeepers were honored and remembered with this monument unveiled in 1982 in Ottawa. For decades, Sarnia, Lambton men and women have served with the Canadian Armed Forces in countless roles in the service to Canada, including patrolling our coasts, monitoring our skies, supporting anti-drug operations, assisting with disaster relief like forest fires and floods and snowstorms and pandemics, as well as leading search and rescue missions. And in one case, a Sarnia native was killed serving in that role. That's his picture at the top right. Sarnia Lambton men and women have also served in Canada's longest war, one where 40,000 Canadians served, 159 lost their lives, including two Sarnians. In November of 2008, through the efforts of Sarnia City Councillor Jim Fobister, this plaque was added to the cenotaph. In June of 2013, a restoration project was completed by the Legion with the assistance of the federal government, repairing damaged joints, cleaning the stone, remounting plaques. In the fall of 2019, the Sarnia Legion and the Sarnia Historical Society completed a refurbishing of the Sarnia Cenotaph that included the addition of 26 names being added to the Sarnia Cenotaph. This was unveiled on that snowy, crisp morning of November 11th that year. And that brings us to where we are now, the 100th anniversary of the Sarnia Cenotaph. And though it's called the Sarnia Cenotaph, it's important to know that many of the names on it are from Lambton County, from Corunna, Courtright, Brigden, Petrolia, and Port Lambton. And behind every carved name in stone is a story of a young man who volunteered to serve, left his school or his job, left his family, who is willing to sacrifice for others. So I encourage you to read some of those stories. And in doing so, you remember not only the fallen, but you also honor all the veterans as well as the families that sacrificed. Now, it was 100 years ago that Mayor George Crawford unveiled the Sarnia Cenotaph. And here are some of his words that I think still resonate today. His words from that unveiling ceremony. He said, quote, "This beautiful monument is a gift of the people of Sarnia to the loving memory of those brave boys who gave their lives in the defense for their king and their country and the cause of justice and liberty. Erecting this monument is a humble way we as a grateful people have undertaken to cherish the memory of our departed and to hand down to succeeding generations the recognition of the noble deeds of those Sarnians that so bravely fought and bled and died on the battlefields of Europe, that the world might be made safe for all."
Thank you.
Tom, I got to say, I'm very impressed by that. That is a definitive history of the Sarnia Cenotaph. And clearly you were the man with the plan and the man that could obviously fulfill this. So thank you so much for everything you've done for our community.
Let me share this. I learned so much when I do this stuff. So
I learned so much. I was just sitting here with Corey and we were just saying, yeah, this must have taken you hundreds, if not thousands of hours to accumulate.
A long time. But I mean, that's like the project, right? I'm fascinated with the stories of these guys and the sacrifices, and what I'm doing pales in comparison what they did. So
well, it's honestly to the benefit of our community to hear about it. So, and I certainly learned a lot. Anyway, Tom, I want to thank you so much for this, and I will see you thank on you. Saturday. And we will hear the condensed version of this, unfortunately. I wish they could all see it. So.